Hi everyone, welcome to our lecture on React. So last time we basically talked about Node.js and Express, which is used for routing. In fact, we have to finish one more topic in that we covered last time, which is routing. So we actually did basic routing with basically the method apt.get or apt.post, apt.put, but we didn't do the router class. So the router class is a more modular way to create mountable router handlers. And basically the idea is that we create an instance of the router class, and then under that router, which can be any link, any path under the server, create the different routes, what will be returned as the response of different routes. So this is a little bit different than what we discussed before. Before we were basically having one route that had either a get or a post or a put function, or we had just special functions that would take the entire path on the server and then it will generate the output back to the client. So in the case of router, we basically create different routers for the different parts of the application. So let's assume that an application, a website, has multiple parts. One part about members, one part about birds, one part about programs, and so on. We can create separate routers for these different parts. So it basically, it modularizes the routing. So I will show you through an example. So consider that one part of the website is about members, and we want to only return basically updates about members. So what we can create, let's actually create an app. So I don't have an app yet. I actually had a app last time, which we can remove now. We can add a folder. Let's add it under on the desktop, and we are going to call it app or Express app. Let's create a new folder here, Express app, and let's add it. So under this folder, we can create a new file, members.js, which only responds back to member request about members. And we basically put this code in, which what it does, it loads the module Express, it creates a router object, and then under this router, you basically can specify what happens when a GET requests come under members, or what happens when a GET request comes under about, under members. And then you export this router. We are going to create also a new file for the main app, app.js. And in app.js, we basically load the app and start it on port 3000. I will explain the code right here. So first we again load the Express module, we create an Express object, we require the members file. So basically we load in members, the members.js file that we created before. We specify that the routing is under members. So under members, it will redirect to that specific router, which is members. And then we start the server on port 3000 and we run it. So let's open the terminal. It's probably under this. Okay. So here we can run node app. We are not in the correct place. Oh no, we are. No. Node app. And basically there are two web pages that we can get to. So the first page is localhost 3,000 members, which is the members homepage. And then there is members about, which is about members. Right under the root of localhost, there is nothing. So basically what we just did, we in the app, we actually specified that all the routing under members is done in the members.js, which does routing under members. We can do other routings. We can say that all the routing under projects is done in another file, projects. So what this does, it basically separates the routing into different files, routing for different parts of our website. So we don't have to create all of the routers in one single place. So what we did, let's recap, and then I will respond to your question, is that we created a members.js, which it's a router for only that part that is under members. And we basically created the routes under members, and we exported this module. Then in the main app, we basically loaded that module that was under members, and we use it under members. So basically the routing for anything that is under the path members is done in members.js. And that's why you have basically what is under members will appear as what is under the root of members. This is the members.js file. And what is under members about will appear under basically again in the members and then about. So we distributed the routing into here is one subset that is this that is responded by members, and maybe there are other subsets. So for instance, I could have had, oh, if I want to process projects, I will do it under projects in some other variable. Okay. And that could be basically another router that is created for projects, which I can create it by just creating something similar to members, copying it and doing routing for projects. Export anything oh, that's a good question. So we saw that we had to export the router. So one thing that we said last time is that if you want to export something from a file, so it's available to other JavaScript objects, you have to export them. So in this case, we are exporting the entire router, basically the router that we did for members as the main, if you are assigning to members here, basically the entire loading of the file members.js, it will basically, the value of members in the other file is actually the object router. So that's what we did. We basically exported the router as being the value of members, and that's what we get as the proper that the object that we are using for routing under members. So module.export is basically a way to export one variable, but under another name. It's basically in some previous languages, it was export by alias. You are giving another alias. So router, the variable router in the file members.js is actually the variable members in the app file.
Can I ask a quick question?
Go ahead.
So this may be me just being behind in terms of web technologies and things, but we can actually send like full HTML instead of just whatever string you specified, right? To like create a full web page.
So here you can basically create anything that you want. This is pure HTML. H1 members. H1 and here, H2, one member is Connor, H2. This, you build this string that you send back in any way that you want, basically. And now if we are reloading members, we have to restart the server. Basically, it's an HTML.
Okay, cool. And then what's the advantage of doing it this way versus just having a page like already created that you just kind of send, you know, like you just load an HTML file?
That is static. So okay. Here, this is can be created from some local variables. Maybe we have a variable S that is, let's say, all. And then when we create this, the output here, it could use that. So it could basically concatenate this with S. So it's really basically that you are creating a dynamic web page. You are sending the response back, but there is no HTML that creates the entire response that contains the response. So you can basically, let's say that your page is searching for a class. So now you have to build the HTML that states this class has all of these properties.
Okay, cool. I think it'll start to make a lot more sense once I get some practice and see how this all works, you know? So, yeah. Okay.
So I actually already decided on the next assignment. The next assignment after we do assignment number 3. So you all know that homework 2 is due tomorrow at midnight. Then homework 3 is really an HTML canvas homework in which with pure JavaScript, you create a static page that basically uses JavaScript to play a game, the classical worm or snake game. But the following assignment, it will be similar to the homework 2, but you're not loading all the courses at once. You're going to implement a form where you enter. It's like Stony Brook class find, SBO class find, which basically you fill in the class that you are looking for and the server will return for you that specific class. Like for instance, 101. And then you get all of the instances of CSC 101. Or in this case, you get other classes too. But basically, we'll do a dynamic website for similar to SBO class find. And here you will basically create the page for that specific class out of JSON objects.
Okay, so sorry, just one more quick question. We need to kind of have a server running enabled in order to I don't know the terminology, I guess a user to send something to the server and then for it to send it back, that needs to be something that's constantly running.
Okay. And that's what we are doing here with Node app. So in the previous lectures that we had, we were just running HTML file. We were just opening with active browser, which basically it was a static file that would open in the browser. But what we are doing now, every time I'm finishing one of these files, I'm actually starting it as a server. And that's why, as opposed to before, when we were entering here, we were just entering an HTML, but now we're actually entering a local host or a host and then a path. And this basically makes a request to the server to return the web page corresponding to that path.
Okay, wonderful. Sorry if other people already know this info.
I think it's totally normal. I have in the lecture notes today a little bit more about this idea of server, client, and database. So it will be clarified in a few moments.
Thank you.
Welcome. Okay, so the second part of our lecture, which is actually the main part of our lecture today, is React. And React is a JavaScript library for building user interfaces or UI components. So what exactly React does, it creates a virtual DOM in JavaScript that mimics the browser DOM. So remember that what was this DOM? It's actually an object, a document object model that is created. It's a tree that is created out of an HTML page. And what we can do with it in JavaScript is modify this tree. We can add nodes, children of parents, and we can modify the attributes, the elements, and so on. What the React does, it lets you actually build this DOM. So even if there is no DOM currently existing, you can build it from scratch, all in JavaScript. You create classes, instances of subclasses of other superclasses that are components in the DOM, and you can build forms, and then you can basically add them, render them to a web page. So what it basically lets you to do is to create an entire DOM, an entire form in pure JavaScript. You don't need to actually do it in HTML and then modify it. You create an entire DOM in JavaScript. And the advantage of this is that it makes web pages look the same. So you basically build in the same way with the same CSS objects and entire web pages. It also lets you create a single page application. Basically what this means is that because you have a DOM that is already created in JavaScript, you can modify it easily. You can modify various parts of this DOM, of this virtual DOM that is created in React. So the web page modifies on the client's browser without having any kind of calls to the server. It was created at Facebook by Jordan Walk in 2012, and then it was used in 2011, it was used in the news feed in Facebook and Instagram. It was released to users in 2013, and it was open sourced in 2015. And since then, basically, it's used in a lot of applications. So first of all, the direct way to see how the React works is to see it directly in HTML files. So really what React is, it's a script. It's a JavaScript script that you can load into your HTML page, and then into your HTML page you can create a DOM and you can attach it to previous elements that existed in your HTML. So the first thing that you can do is to add these three scripts, which basically what they are doing, they are loading React, they are loading React DOM and Babel. And basically React and React DOM are for creating this React virtual DOM. And Babel is for writing in a separate type of syntax called JSX syntax, JavaScript XML. And really the reason there is that you want to have a scripting language that is not JavaScript, but allows you to actually embed in the language HTML tags without having to have strings. They are similar to what JSP was for Java server pages. Those of you that ever programmed web applications in Java, you know that there are at least two ways to actually create Java web applications. One is with servlets, which is really very similar to what we were doing with Express. It's a file written in pure Java that creates an HTML page that is sent to the client. And the second one was with a template called JSPs, Java Server Pages, that would allow you to mix HTML tags with JavaScript code, with Java code. JSX is something similar. It lets you mix JavaScript code with HTML tags so you can build this HTML that is sent to the server dynamically. So the first thing that we are going to load are three different React libraries, modules from a content network. You can also have them on your own machine, really. I found them that they are available online, which is really cool because I don't have to create my own, to put them in my own app. And then you can create an HTML file that basically uses React. And here is the script for React. So first thing, I created a division with my div as the ID. And then I have this code, which is JavaScript. Actually, it's not quite JavaScript, it's Babel, that basically it's a mix of JavaScript. There is a class hello that extends React component and a method render, a function render in it. But then when we return a value, this is HTML code that is an H1 tag, but I don't have to use quotes because this is basically a mix of JavaScript with HTML tags. So it's JSX format. And after I created that class, hello, I called the method render for the React DOM to return back hello, and then the output, basically the text that was rendered by the class hello is returned in the element with ID my div. So the question that I see in the chat is that, do we have to use all the technologies discussed in this class to do the final project, or some frameworks are redundant if we use more powerful ones? And the answer is that basically I'm teaching you different ways to do things. So for instance, we learned that you can modify the DOM with JavaScript, or you can use the jQuery to modify the DOM. And they have advantages, one versus the other. jQuery is shorter. Direct JavaScript is basically, you don't need to use another module that loads, you're loading from somewhere else. And this is exactly the same when we talk about React versus just doing it with Node directly. So with React, really what you're doing is a simplified way to modify the website, okay? And this way is that I'm creating a virtual DOM, and this is what is done in this class. We are creating a component, a DOM component, and we just render it. So it's a simplified way to do what we did before with pure JavaScript, okay? So let me show you this in effect. So as I said, I'm going to copy this code, which all that does, it loads React library in an HTML file. And I'm going to create a new file in my module. Let's call it index.html. And in index.html, I put my code, which really what it does, it loads those libraries and it uses React to create an HTML DOM, and then put this HTML DOM corresponding to the hello class into the element with ID div, my div. So I'm going to run this with live server, which really what it does, it just loads that class, which basically creates the hello world in an H1 tag, header one. So this is basically it. We are creating a DOM virtually, and we are adding this DOM at runtime to the web page. Okay. So now let's dig into more advanced issues regarding React. Okay, let's see what. Can we return different HTML attributes? Yes. Can we combine React with servers? Yes, like Express. Basically, we are going to combine it first with pure Node without even dealing with Express. But then we are also going to combine it with Express. Okay, good. So React applications, these classes that we created, like the hello class here, they have two things. They have the state, which actually, what happens is that you are sending the state from the client to the server sends it back to the client. So you don't need to track the state yourself. React does it for you. Basically, it loads it into cookies and sends it between the server and the client. So you have the idea that you basically have a state that is exchanged. It also renders the page updates based on that state, okay? And to really understand what really React is to understand the MVC architectural design pattern. So at some point, a little bit, a couple of years ago, Facebook described React as the V in MVC, okay? By this, I mean React. So really what do we have to know is what is MVC, the MVC design patterns. It's MVC stands for Model View Controller. It's a design pattern. It's not a framework like Rails, Cake, PHP, Django, and so on. It's really an idea of how web applications work. And most web frameworks incorporate concepts of MVC. So this is what a web application does. Basically, the client in some browser sends a request to a server. The server queries some database, relational or NoSQL database. It gets back some responses. It creates dynamically an HTML that is sent back to the client. And usually this is seen as a model view controller architecture. Basically, the view is what the client sees, and the client changes that view, which basically it's an event that is sent to the controller, like update the view or add another user. The controller or the server queries a database, like creates another tuple in a relational database, gets back the result. If it queried the database, it would get back some tuples. It would create the view and sends it back to the client. And React really is the view. So the React, as I said, is used to create a virtual DOM. And the DOM is really an HTML, basically the way that we are seeing an HTML. And Facebook basically presented React as the view. Now, lately, because React is really somewhere that is the view, but also the controller, Facebook now basically says that is a JavaScript environment or framework that helps you. Because basically these classes are executed and they are not especially the view. They are somewhere between. You basically, it's more on the controller side that you are running JavaScript code to generate the view that the client sees. So really the way that you should see this is that the database is the model, and any kind of code that affects the structure of the database is called the model. The code that processes the data from the database prior to the view is the controller, and the output that you see in your browser is the view. And React is somewhere around here. It's part of the controller and part of the view because is basically JavaScript that can run both on the server, but it can also run on the client because we saw it in the HTML, we ran it on the client. So in order to learn and use React, you should set up a React environment on your computer. And the first thing that you have to do is to install with NPM. We talked about NPM last time, is the package manager for Node. The Create React App. So Create React App is the officially supported way to create React applications. So you basically, if you already have everything that we installed in the last few lectures, like for instance, you have Node and you have Visual Studio Code or VS Code, you should basically install your React App. You can run it. It will take about a couple of minutes first time you install it, but afterwards, basically it knows that it's already there and basically it installs everything that is necessary. So that's the first step. The next step is that you have to use it in order to create everything that you need to create a new React application. So NPX is actually similar to NPM. It's part of the NPM package manager that comes with Node, but it allows you to actually do a few things. It lets you actually use a package to create other packages, or it lets you to use packages even without installing them. So if I would have installed the package React, not globally, but even not install it with minus D, it would only download the repository but not install it, I can still use NPX to use that package on in a specific application, not on all applications, okay? So it basically lets you just use it in some applications, which is quite a useful feature to have. So what you should do to run your first React application is to run this command npx and create your first application. So in this case, I called it my first React. And this may also take a couple of seconds. Last time it took basically about a minute. So it installs React, React DOM, React Scripts, everything that you need to run your first React application in your project. And it doesn't take that much. Let's actually wait for it to be done. So really what it does, it creates wizards that allows you to basically write the server side and the client side in for a React application. Okay. It should take very few seconds left. Good. We are done. So now if we look at our directory, we have our my first React application. We can change to my first React application. And here we can run npm start. And this starts the server for my first React application. And it basically loads that web page, which is just a simple web page added by default. Welcome to React. To start, edit the app.js in sources and save it. And that basically, you can start modifying your React. And so what we just did are multiple things. And I will explain to you directly in the slides. Basically what we did, we installed this app developed by Node to create React applications. And we created our first React project, which is really, as I described in NPM, in Model View Controller, is in the middle. It runs both on the server, but it creates the loader that loads it on the client. And this is extremely important that you're not developing a project that runs part of it on the server and parts of it in the browser. So you're creating a virtual DOM on the server, you send the DOM to the browser and the browser renders that DOM on the screen. So that's very important because what we just did, we actually created an application that resides in two different, it's a distributed application. It resides on two different computers in general or multiple. Now, if you want to modify this app, so you can basically open the app.js and right now it returns that DOM that we saw before. But if we want to render a different DOM, we can basically create an app that extends React component and render a different DOM in the render method. We basically say hello world and that will be rendered in the browser. So let me show you that. So if you look at my first React application, it has multiple folders. In sources, I have app.js, which basically it's the app that will be rendered. And that's basically what's rendered by index.js. So what when we are rendering something, we render it from this place, basically from index.js. In app.js, we have the object that we are creating for our app. And if I want here, let's actually add a header. Header one, let's call it, let's put something that is specific to me, Paul Fodor. Okay, now if we look at our application, it starts with Paul Fodor and the React app. Okay, let's see the questions. I'm going deeply into Node and React, so. Okay. Node.js path has to be into your path. So when you installed, so I think Ricky is right. The question from Keating is, I tried npm installed and it didn't work. I assume that basically Node.js, which is basically npm installer, also has to be in your path, which is part of the installer. You should check that. I don't know what the rest of the questions are really asking for, but I assume that is the same. Okay, good. You can follow the video and the lecture notes after the class anyway. So let's actually close this routing and return back to React. So if you want, you can modify directly your app. Another way is now you basically can install other tools in VS Code. So another tool that we are going to install and is quite useful is actually this simple React snippets in VS Code. And let me show you this extension. So if you go to extensions, and I already have installed it, React, but if you just search for React, one of the top tools is simple React snippets. You install it. And what this gives you, it gives you an easier way, is like shortcuts to create new components or at any time. Okay. So that's one, that one that we use. The second one is Prettier Code Formatter. So again, search for it, install it, and then restart Visual Studio Code. Also install Bootstrap. So Bootstrap is a CSS and JavaScript library that basically it was developed originally by Twitter. And it's a CSS that lets you basically, it has already loaded CSS, nice style sheets for creating web pages. I'm using it for a lot of applications, including the course website. If you ever looked at our course website, page source, one of the things that I'm using it, Bootstrap. And it's used in many different places in my code. Just to make it nicer, there are already classes that are predefined and I can give them nice look. So you can basically use them in your classes. Also, there is one here that allows you to collapse and open basically the timesheet, the times of instructors and so on. So I'm not going to use it today that much. So don't worry about that. It's really, I'm going to use it in one of the future classes. So install Bootstrap. It also create a development folder, drop the development folder in Visual Studio Code, create a new application, and in the terminal window, navigate to the developer folder and run create app, my first React. This is really summing up what we did in the previous few steps. Okay, so now we have opened Visual Studio in our first React app, and you should have three folders, node modules, public, and sources. Index.js is your main entry point for your React app. And you can now basically add another line, which is importing Bootstrap to create better looking applications. So index.js, and here we can add additional apps, like for instance, adding this Bootstrap. Good. In the source folder, create a new folder called components. So now we can start creating our own components. So in the source folder, we create a new folder, let's call it components. And in this new components, I can create any new component that I want. I can create, for instance, newapp.jsx. So JSX is really like JavaScript, but it lets you mix JavaScript with HTML tags. So here you can basically start filling in basically React classes and objects. Now, you can create a React class from scratch by writing the code like we did here, but you can also use shortcuts. IMRC is basically to create a new component. CC is to create a class. So to import component, and one is to create a class. So import RC and press tab, and that basically fills in the import statement. CC, press tab, and you created a new component. And now new app. So we just created a new app, and in the return method, you can return basically these tags that you want, like for instance, H1, poll. Good. I don't know why it feels here, but poll. Okay, and we export this into new app. Now you can go to the JS file, import it. So import new app from, and we put it in components, new app. And then we basically, instead of returning app as the result of our page, return new app. So now if we return back to see our page, basically our web page just became poll. So what we did is the following. Basically we created a new app, and in this is a new React component. And in this React component, we basically imported component from React, which is the main class that must be extended by any subclass of these React components. And as I said, it has two parts. It has the state and the method render. So the state is all of the objects that are basically exchanged between the client and the server. So you know, it's like a stateful, who's the user, what are the user credentials, what are the objects that were added. So these are exchanged at every interaction between the client and the server. Render is the method that actually creates this component dynamically. So you can use variables, but you can also use HTML tags. When you export the class that you created, the component that you created, as the object that is exported by this component, by this specific JSX file. So the state holds the state information. The render is basically the function that renders the page dynamically from the state. All the code will be basically as XML, but really that's those are tags that will be HTML tags. The value that is returned has to be in one single level. So even if you have multiple elements, create a super element that contains all of them. So in our example here, if I wanted to create a new app, let's say a div, and under this div, this is the main component. There is an H1 tag, maybe there is an H2 tag. And then the div ends. So It has to be a tree that contains one node at the root, and then you can have any more nodes under it. So it's really not a problem how it looks like, okay? Good. Now, one other thing is that this file, we can actually save it both as JSX or as pure JavaScript. That's also fine because it's really JSX, even if it's JSX, it's JavaScript. Okay. The pretty printer doesn't seem to work, but it's okay. Okay. And now if we look at our app, it contains basically that page, Paul as the header one and Fodor as the header two. Good. So now when we return back to index.js, which was the main entry point to our basically code, we imported our new app, this app that we created, test app is the name that I gave here, and I imported it from the components test app, and then I rendered it in the DOM. So basically when we open it on the website, this virtual DOM is materialized and it contains everything that we rendered in the test app, okay? How is it included in the test app? Basically, we are getting an element by ID root, and that root is actually an ID that was created by all of this infrastructure for us in the index.html file. So if you are looking at index.html in our browser, we can actually see that we have the division, which is root. So really what React does for us, it populates that HTML page, index.html, the root division with everything that we have into this document, new app. And it just materializes into that file. Another example, and then I will take a few questions because I saw a lot of questions in the chat, is how to create a counter. So let's assume that what we want to create is a counter that increments every time the user clicks a plus one button, increment button. So we do exactly the same thing as before. We import React. Then we create a new class that extends component. It has a state, and this state starts with the count zero. Then it has a method, handle increment, which is a function that takes no arguments, but what it does, it increments the state, this dot sets the state, the value of count to this state.count plus one. So it basically what it does is for the current object, it increments the counter with one. For the same state, the same count element, it basically variable, it increments with one. The render method now is much bigger. It basically, it's a division which spans the count, the this.format count basically returns the count. And this is basically put in a span of font size of 20. And then I'm creating a button, and this button has an event handler on it. When I click on the button, it calls the method handle increment. So it calls this method that we have here. And the rest is basically that we have a batch class that returns the current class, starts with the counter zero. And we have a format counter, which takes a look at if the counter is zero, it actually prints zero. Otherwise, it prints the actual counter. And we export the counter. So note that this is JavaScript XML. So it lets you basically mix JavaScript with XML in this return statement. So you don't need to code these divisions. In fact, if you code them, you are getting a string that contains div and so on. You really, what you are doing, you are creating a HTML as part of the return. And this is compiled by that Babel package that we loaded. So the text that is sent is not HTML, is sent as Babel, which is another word for saying that is a mixed output. So let me show you this application. So we will create a counter class in our components, counter.js or JSX. It's really up to you what extension you want to use. Then we are going to paste this entire code, which basically imported the React, created a class that implements a component, created a variable count within the current state. It implemented the methods for handle, increment, the render method, which returns basically the counter. And then we have these other two methods, which are basically get badge and format counter. And we export the counter. So now if we return back to our index.js, we can import the new class. So import counter from components counter. And now we change, we are going to output counter. Okay. It failed to compile. Okay, let's see what it failed to compile. I didn't notice.
New app is okay. New app doesn't exist. It's components. Let's delete this. We're not using it anymore.
Good. It compiled well. And now if we return back to our React app, basically it's this counter. So one advantage of this entire thing is that both the server and the client have the same state. So this, the whole point of React is that you don't need to send from the server to the client various objects. This is all handled by the framework for you. So basically what we did here, we redirected the document route to the counter, which we imported from counter.js, JSX, and then we basically created this React component that has a state and has the rendering method for that state, and also functions that are feeding that rendering method. So let's take questions, and then we'll have to cover the rest of React. So there are lots of questions here. So yes, we installed two plugins. I installed actually just one plugin. So one plugin was the Easy React Creator, and the other one was Pretty Printer. So simple React snippets and prettier code formatter. Those are the two plugins that I installed, nothing else. Let's see what other questions were there. In Node.js, I installed the Create React app. I'm loading it from CDN, that's true, in the first HTML application. I didn't actually use Bootstrap up to now, except that I'm loading it for this counter application. Yes, the file extension was the issue. You're completely right. That's why the app, the component new app didn't work. So if I change this to JSX, so there was not a problem when I loaded it as the only one, but it was a problem when I also wanted to load the counter. So now I can load the new app without problems. Okay. So now there is no problem, no more errors. I'm using new app. If you want to swap between the counter application and new app, you basically easily can do that swap. And now it basically loads new app. And if you want the counter, it loads the counter. Okay. Let's see what other questions were there. Chat. What's the point of React? Okay. So the point of React is that multiple points. First point is that you don't need to send the state to the client and from the client to send back the state to the server, because this is all done for you by the React framework. So one thing about servers is that they don't know the state of every single client, independent client. So what this allows you to do is to have different states for different clients, because these states are created individually for every client. Okay. So if I have multiple tabs, for instance, for my React app, okay, I have an increment here and I have an increment here, and I can basically, I have two applications which are basically running on the same server. They each have their individual state, which is extended exchange with the server in the background. I don't have to handle any of that. Can you render two or more components? Yes, we are going to do that for a form in a couple of minutes. Also, React makes web developer more modular and single site applications. That's completely true. And we'll see more of these features. Okay, good. So let's return back to the lecture. So this is the counter. So React also supports JavaScript events. And these events, basically you can attach them, as we saw in the case of counter, with on click. So basically what we are doing here, we have the button, and then on click, it runs the method. In this case, this handle event, handle increment. So this on click basically is an attribute of button, and it lets you combine basically this HTML looking code with the JavaScript code. As opposed to the methods that we saw before on click for JavaScript, which were basically functions, you need to put parentheses. Now you basically just state that this is an attribute that is equal with, and it's equal with the value of the current React opt component handle increment variable. So it's really, instead of having methods, you are having variables whose value is actually a method. React provides also HTML forms. So you can actually pass values from HTML to React, JavaScript, and back. It's similar to events, only that all the names are coded camel case, on change, not on underscore change, on submit, when the form is submitted, and they are variables. So here I have an example for that. Basically, I have a form which reads a username. The handler for this form, based on the when the event happens, we are opening an alert, an HTML alert, that we submitted this with the user, the current user, in this case myself, Paul. Also, I'm setting the username to the event target value. Then in the render method, I invoke the two methods. On submit for the current form, we'll call the mySubmit handler. And on change, if I change basically the text into the input, it will invoke the myChange handler. So basically I'm invoking two JavaScript methods in this React example, which are in the JavaScript component that I have before. So let me show you how this works. Basically, what are the different two methods that will fire, and when do they fire them in the form? So the form here is created, again, as a mix of HTML with JavaScript in React. So This is a React component. So again, we are going to create a component. My form. I'm pretty sure it's my form. .jsx. And my form basically contains this code. All the code that I have in the lecture notes, I tested many, many times. So they it actually works fine. And I exporting my form. And now in my, let's close this, in my JS file, I'm importing my form from components, my form. And if we open our page, basically it has this hello, enter your name and submit, Paul Fodor. And as I basically every time I change, it calls that method that we saw on change. Submit, and it creates an alert. You are submitting this as Paul Fodor. Now, all of this is maintained both on the server and on the client. So this is one advantage, my opinion, the biggest advantage of React. So in this code that I wrote in my form, basically I'm creating all of this. First thing that I have is I'm creating a state, which is part of the basically the current username for the current state is empty. Then I'm creating the two handlers. The handler, it's an anonymous function that takes the event for the submit button, the clicking on the button, and the other one for changing the field. And the first one, what it does, it creates an alert. And you are submitting this as the username. And the second one, it changes the state. The value username is the value of the event target value. And in this case, the target is actually the input. So that method, my change handler, is called when the input is modified on change. Okay. And the button, which, so another thing here, hello, this.state.username, the username is taken from the current objects, the current React's object, username. The submit button for the entire form, it's my submit handler. So basically it's a mix of JavaScript with HTML, which is coded for this specific React framework. Okay. You can have as many variables in the state as you want. So the state is really a list of variables. In this case, I have only one, but you can add as many as you want. So another one, let's say age equals 0. And you can use it. Age colon 0, sorry. So if I want, let's say that I want also the age, maybe hello, this of age. This.state.age. Okay. So now basically my React says hello, Paul of age 0. Okay. You can have as many variables as you want in your state. That's not the problem. Yep. Good. You're welcome. Okay, so let's return back to the slides on React. So React supports CSS style information inside the JSX. Since JavaScript expressions are encased into brackets and JavaScript objects also use braces, style information will be in two sets of braces. So if you want to change the background color or the font family, you will see two curly braces around the values for basically these properties. So here I have an example where basically I create a CSS app whose state is empty, and in the render method, I'm creating my face is red and I want to style it red. I have two sets of curly braces. The style is equal with curly brace for React, curly brace for actually specifying a style property. Color should be red. Okay. And let's actually try it because it's again another React component. So this is CSS app. And in this CSS app, I'm going to put this entire code. And in my index, I'm going to import it. Here and here, done. And now basically it's my try of styles, of modifying the styles in React. Okay. So the ways that you basically modify React functions can be defined in two ways. You can define the function instead of stating change color equal an anonymous lambda function, open close parentheses, arrow, this set, this dot set state color blue. You can also do it in the standard way that we did it in JavaScript before, but you need to bind this to actually the React object. So the problem is that this version requires some additional annotation that I will show you next. So in all our code, I'm using this notation, the arrow notation, because it's much better and it's easier to write in code, okay? This is how you would do it if you want to set basically the color, this to be the current object. So in the method constructor, you have to do this.changeColor equal this.changeColor bind to the current this object. Otherwise, when you do this.setState, it doesn't know that this is the React object. It's kind of a mouthful, and that's why I never actually do it this way. I always prefer and tell you to do it with equal. So this is basically how I did it here in the form. My submit handler equal and then the handler. And similarly for this one. So I'm never doing it as a method because that would be, I would have to do another annotation that says this for every one of those methods refers to the current object. I'd expect you not to do it. Okay. So let's take a few questions. What does constructor and super do? Basically like in Java. I can't see it because of this. So like in Java, all of these classes that we've wrote, counter and so on, are extending another super class in. So they are basically object-oriented programming in JavaScript. So constructor is basically what you have as a constructor in Java, but you are not using the name of the class, you are using constructor, and super calls the super class constructor. Now, one thing that I observed in some of my code is that when I actually use the superclass constructor, it, I think in the CSS one or my form one, it shows me that it's deprecated. So I would expect that superclass constructor is always called by default. So probably you shouldn't use it anymore. I haven't seen it used in a while. So probably they add it as an update. I just updated today to version 14. I still had version 11, which I found out that is end of life was last year. But version 12 is long-term LTS. So you should use version 12, which lasts for another 2 years. Version 14, which was released this August, basically is the version that you should use, I think. There are versions both for NPM and also for Node. So you should check them from time to time to make sure that you're still basically using a current version. I'm using version 12, which is LTS. So I'm not using the latest version of Node. I'm using the long-term support one. Okay, good. The state is saved on both the client and the server. That's the advantage, one of the advantages of React. So you are treated as, you're treating it for that object as a global variable. Good. So that's all for today. One thing that I want to remind you is the fact that the assignment 2 is due at midnight tomorrow, and assignment 3 is posted. Also, next week we'll have our first midterm, and the topics that you should read the slides, and I still don't have an exam for next week, but I will create one in Lockdown Browser, is the topics for next, the exam are everything that we cover up to the day of the exam. So it will be the theory of software development lifecycle, if you know basically the steps in a waterfall model, that's good enough, and then basics of web development, HTML, CSS, JavaScript, HTML DOM, and how to modify it with JavaScript, jQuery, HTML Canvas, Node.js and Express, React, and the next class it will be on Git. So it will be a light class before the midterm. The format of the midterm is unknown yet. I'm teaching this class for the first time. So it will be on Lockdown Browser, multiple questions. I do not know if probably there will be multi-choice questions and a mix of multi-choice questions with write fill in the gap questions. Depending on basically this weekend, I will create an exam. I do not have a practice exam. I'm sorry, because this is the first time I'm teaching it, but I will make it easier for everyone. So basically you, if you read the lecture notes and you did your homeworks, you should be able to do the exam. The midterm is posted on the course website. Next class is GitHub, as you can see, and the following class is the midterm on Thursday. Midterm. Okay, thank you very much. Let's stop the recording. I will post it on Piazza after the class today. See you next week.